Okay, so you might be thinking, wait, I thought I already watched this video. Does this look familiar? Well, here's why. I recently posted a video with this exact same footage, but talked a whole lot about composition and bravery and creative journeys and didn't teach you actually how to paint the thing. So I figured, well, let's teach him how to paint the thing. Here we go. And you know what? It wouldn't be a bad idea for you to go and watch this video first, get yourself acquainted with the supplies and all the things, and then come on back. Or just stick with me. So we're using that Ecoline, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, watercolor brush pens. You can see right there on the cover, they call them brush pens. But let me tell you, friends, these act more like markers. The points are stiffer and the barrels are fatter. And so, do you get the precision you might get with, say, Kuretake's Zig clean color brush pens? No, but I'm loving these so much. I'm using Academy Rough watercolor paper today, which I can tell you works really beautifully with these markers. And honestly, I was first drawn to this yellow color. And so that's what inspired me to paint poppies today. So let's pop this open and get it going. This is going to feel a lot like sketching when we start. I'm going to make a really wavy, wiggly petal here, imagining where the center will be just below, a few strokes, a few squiggles. And then I'm going to grab this peachy color and fill in a little bit, not coloring in a solid area, just a few little squiggles. And then I'm going to take a clean brush full of water, my 3/4 inch flat wash brush, and swiggle and smooth it around. You know, I'm just making up my own vocabulary here, but it's okay. And I'm seeing how the pigment in these markers moves around. And it takes a little coaxing, but it starts to move around. So I'm gonna add another really sketchy, scribbly petal here. You can kind of see the shape taking form. Another one that's curving upwards a little bit. And then another down here to the left that's also curving upwards. And then bringing back that yellow. And then we've got our fifth petal, all yellow. And that one is decidedly curving upwards. You can see the shapes of my strokes. These aren't as much shapes that I'm sketching as they are sketchy lines, but they're all radiating around an imaginary center that I'm leaving white. But notice these petals taper ever so subtly and get skinnier as they meet the center of the flower. Now I'm just taking clean water and smoothing things around. I want to go right into the center. I feel like I need the structure of a flower center, and I'm creating a really kind of scratchy circle, an outline circle, and then going right in and doing a half circle with the darker green and a few dots. And almost perpendicular to the page, I'm adding in some of the ruffles at the center of a poppy flower. I'm not sure what they're called, stamens, ruffles. I don't know what, but you know what I'm talking about. Next, I'm grabbing this teal color and making even more contrast here at that half circle point. I'm not doing any real continuous lines. I'm lifting up, dragging, and kind of dashing the marker along as I make all of these strokes. This is like a darker green and just dabbing, 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 more contrast. I want to accentuate those ruffly centers that these gorgeous poppies have. Now, a clean-ish brush, and I'm using it almost perpendicular to the page, just clean water. And that way I can go in and further define this gorgeous sword-like leaf with some of that teal color. Pay attention to how you're holding these markers. You don't have to hold them like traditional pencil or a brush. You can hold them just like this and give you a little bit more freedom and expressive lines. Love that. Second green on there, and look at how they are blending because I put down that water first. Now, a really loose-handed stem starting to kind of encircle around the leaf and that main flower, and a little bit more just clean water to simply define a pod that I'm now defining with the green marker. So I love that idea of painting with clean water and then sketching into the clean water with your marker to start to define the form. So fun. And then you get this gorgeous diffused line. And if you have the patience to let it go, it'll continue to bleed and diffuse and blend into that water that you first laid down, just like this. Friends, don't be afraid to use a lighter color marker, a little bit over top of a darker color, and then just work it out in another area where you can bleed out some of that contaminated quote unquote color. So don't worry about lighter on darker with these markers. You won't ruin them, I promise. Same sketchy marks here with this side view flower that's drooping downwards, the two yellow colors, and then blend, blendy, blend with a little clean water on that dagger brush. Now these markers don't lay down a ton of wet pigment, but they still are damp. So as like I'm adding the green here, for example, I'm running into the yellows a bit and they are bleeding together, but in such a lovely way that it doesn't bother me. It is so not out of control and I'm just flowing with it. So good. Now, you know me, I couldn't hold out for much longer with a pink, so I'm adding little touches of unexpected pink around the center of this focal point flower and a little bit on this droopy downward facing bloom because it just feels good and right. I will say that pink is not nearly as fluorescent as I was expecting. I'm happy to report that these colors aren't necessarily as staining as I was fearing they would be. They certainly are staining the paper, but you still can move them around a few minutes after you've initially laid down the color. Here, I'm going in and just pressing really hard and letting the color bleed into the wet areas and then lightening up on my pressure and getting in some gorgeous, whimsical movement lines like that. Oh, this is my jam. Y'all know how I feel about linear details. And if you're wondering, Christy, what's a linear detail? I want you to check out this video actually because it talks about all the different painting techniques that I use. It's great if you're a beginner and if you're feeling a little overwhelmed right now, it's probably a good one to watch and then come back here. Okay, I'm using that technique where I paint with water first. This is an upward facing petal and then some scratchy marks right into the wet with the two colors, the peach and the yellow. And notice how my marks of those petals are all facing upward. And that just keeps the movement and the natural vibe of the petal going. Now I added these stems running right off the page and I immediately felt like it was a bad decision. I needed some more weight, some visual weight down there. So I'm painting in some wet areas and I'm gonna create this gorgeous cluster of plump little pods. I always forget that name, pods. So now I'm using my markers again and creating contour lines around the shape of the wet area I just painted with my clean brush, continuing to contour around on each side of that lazy oval that I painted in with water and adding a few different colors. Add those colors just in a soft V-shaped area at one end of the pod or the other. So it feels like that those new petals are just about to burst through the shell of the pod. Love that so much. So sorry, friends, that I went off camera here, but I think you get the gist. I'm so getting used to my new camera, working on it. You'll notice in this area a lot, I've been holding the marker almost perpendicular to the page, which means my hand is in the way of you seeing what I'm doing. But this is really helpful when I am adding linear details and stems. It gives me the ability to move in a fluid way, but still have the control I need to create the shapes I'm after. I do want to take a moment to point out that if you don't have these markers, because friends, I'll be honest, they are not cheap. And this was a gift that I got for the holiday season. If you don't have these markers, don't feel like you need to run out and get them to create this painting. You can create this painting with traditional pan watercolors and a round brush or the dagger. You really can. Totally doable. All right, adding another pod up here and have one facing up to the sky and then one drooping down. The thing with poppies, pods without poppies and poppy flowers without pods, they kind of go together. You need one for the other to feel like a real poppy, in my humble opinion. And especially those drooping pod stems, so iconic to the poppy. So think about working that into your composition. Adding another big leaf over here and working in some darker teal moments all throughout this painting to just start to build up that contrast. I am known for these type of very organic compositions that kind of work all around the page, almost making your eye go in a circle. And the thing that I do as I'm working is making sure to remind myself not to lay down the same amount of detail on all areas of the painting. So something to think about. Now here, for a bit of contrast of shape and scale, I am adding all of these upward facing poppies from a side view, but they are decidedly smaller in scale because I want them to fade a little bit into the background visually. And this is more of a compositional conversation because that big bold peony in the center is the focal point, even though I wish it wasn't exactly in the center, but it is. So these smaller poppies all facing upward and a little bit to the left, like they're reaching for the sun, are smaller by design. And now I'm going to add in some smaller green filler moments, a few descending scratchy shapes right next to each other, going large to small, and then connecting them with super fine wispy stems. And there you have some gorgeous filler. These markers do have some flex to them. So remember, press down a little bit on them. You're going to get a wider mark that's going to force a bleed into a damp area if you are working in a damp area like I am still now. Or really, really light pressure is going to give you those super thin, fine lines. Keep that in mind as you work. I definitely approach this composition from a more traditional aspect of working light colors to dark. And so now I'm kind of in my third inning with some really dark indigo moments to really make those pods pop and bring in some linear detail into the leaves and even the center of that poppy to really help things start to jump off the page. But again, remembering I don't want everything to jump off the page. So I'm keeping my desire to just love on this indigo color in check. Now I'm adding some really speckly fine moments here with a little bit of wash of water over top for some filler flower moments. These could be delphinium, lisianthus, you name it, anything, lupin, anything that has kind of that multi-flower, stretchy, swaggy feel, this could be. And I just adore this color. It tones things down a little bit, keeps the yellows from being too garish. So friends, I would love it. Head into comments, introduce yourself, tell us why you're here and what you're inspired by these days. Happy painting until next time. And if you love this, I would say watch this one next.